We don't have a forum, so. Do we have any public comment on agenda items? Approval of the board minutes, we'll have to table to see if we end up getting one, so. Public safety report.
Okay, Tom is here, we now have forum.
Okay. Okay, let's go back to approval of the board minutes. Everybody had a chance to review the meeting minutes from 5:11.
One second.
On favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extension?
I wasn't here, so I think it's all right.
Officer Lopez?
Yes, oh. You know, not a whole lot to report, you know, we have the new chief, so, running department, so. There's not much to report around here right now.
For our presentations, an addition from the LA.
Actually, Bird.
Okay.
He's.
I might have just walked in. Okay, we're gonna have one presentation. Yeah, go, yeah, go for it, of course. Linda, you're up.
Oh, okay, I thought I was second. I'm happy to go.
Okay, grab your go.
So I just wanted to introduce myself. I'm Linda Dishman, the president and CEO of the Los Angeles Conservancy. For those of you that aren't familiar with our work, we advocate for saving and reusing historic buildings. We do a lot of work downtown, although we are countywide, so we are stretched a little thin sometimes. But we do a lot of activities downtown. And in 2013, we did a tour of the Arts District because of the kind of the growth and everything. And we had over 900 people down in the Arts District for a day, which we were very excited about. And from some of that work, we've been working with Yuval and Dan Rosenfeld and Michael Chansey. We've been working with different property owners down in the Arts District. And we began to see that with the downtown community plan, that there was an opportunity to make sure that the growth in the Arts District kind of went toward incorporating the historic buildings into the future development, which is something that we really felt strongly about. And so we pulled together a group of people that was Dan and Yuval, that was really tied to the Zoning Advisory Committee, which is part of RECODE LA. So that's more alphabet than me. But anyway, it's kind of tied to this RECODE process, which is going to have new tools for planners to use in terms of all kinds of development in the city. And we've been meeting for about a year and a half, 2 years. And the idea was, to how do we incentivize people to keep their existing and historic buildings? We don't want it to be a stick as much as we want there to be a really good carrot. And so the idea was we would do transfer of development rights within the district. So if you own a historic building, you would be able to transfer your development to another parcel. They would buy it from you. So you could use that money to restore the building, you know, whatever. So that's kind of the principle of it. I have a worksheet I can hand out, and Dan, you've been.
Well, yeah, Linda's identified an issue I think that we've all thought a great deal about, and that given that the character of this neighborhood, the Arts District, is so much defined by the scale and texture of the buildings over here, the older buildings with the boat houses and the brick walls and the restaurants. I mean, those are beautiful buildings, but they're not landmarks per se. In the city, there are provisions to protect landmarks, like the Bradford. And I presume the Biscuit building is a landmark. I mean, but there aren't many buildings, many of them, that are not landmarks, but they contribute to the character of the neighborhood. And under the current sort of Wild West free-for-all of rezoning, it's in an owner's economic interest to tear down a one-story building with 1.5 times coverage in industrial commercial use and build a 6-story or a 10-story or a 35-story building on that site, you know, and try to get a variance for additional coverage. Clearly, there's an economic motive that threatens a lot of the buildings that make this neighborhood so attractive. So the question the Conservancy asked is how do we don't want to force people to keep buildings as much as we might like them to. It's not a requirement, it's an incentive. What would make it economically attractive to some of the faculty fact, replace buildings to keep the scale and quality of the buildings that are there. And the idea that you came up with is a pretty simple one. If you assigned additional density to those buildings and allowed the owner to sell that density in exchange for keeping the low-rise, authentic, historic building, they would realize some money that might make it more attractive to keep the building. And that's sort of where how the idea evolved. And then we started talking to Ken Bernstein at the city's historic preservation officer, to Brian Eck, who's working on the community plan. We found that other cities, San Francisco, Seattle, are wrestling with the same issue in their historic districts. And it's not a perfect idea. It's hard to explain in many ways. And I don't know how it would work in practice. You have a donor zone like the Arts District who could sell excess, or transfer excess FAR. And you need a receiver zone of places who could accept it to build more. But if you could create, and right now the Tea Farm Market's nominated by the city because they have the convention center with FAR coming out their ears to set the price and dominate the market. But could you create a private market that, you know, it's like cap and trade sort of, I guess, in a sense, in the carbon market, where it's in people's economic interest to keep buildings. And I keep thinking of Brera because it's my favorite space.
Yeah.
But all the buildings that have the historic character.
Who's going to identify the historic nature of the buildings? Because some buildings obviously.
So Survey LA, which is a city project, they surveyed the entire city, has identified historic buildings within the Arts District that are individually eligible, and they've also identified a district. Mm-hmm. So anything that is a contributing building within the district, which is like 1st and 7th to Mateo and... So if within that area, it kind of carves around, in terms of parking lots and different things. But I have a map. I did bring a few maps if people want to see what that historic district was like. Let me just pass me that.
So you said you also identified a receiving area?
So that this is not a final, we're not coming to you saying, do you love this?
Right.
We're coming out and get input. So,
how do we make it work?
Yeah.
Is it a worthwhile thing? I think is the first question.
So,
And if so, how do you make it work?
And we've got the feedback in terms of the process. But so the question you asked is sort of who's eligible. The idea would be that if you are, a contributing structure within a district, that you would be eligible. The goal is to, make sure that there's something of value in terms of it's a character building, that we're not saving kind of tilt up concrete buildings from the 60s or something. But that, all these buildings that make the Arts District so special, because our concern was, this is the Arts District, it looks like the Arts District, you start taking all the buildings down, it's not going to be the Arts District anymore, it's going to be a sign on a neighborhood, it's not going to be a place. And so that, how do we get around the concept of saving these buildings? And part of that is that the new development really needs these character buildings to be the restaurants and the creative office space and the coffee shops and the gyms, and because that's why people live here, is because it's a special place. And so that is a large part of it, as Dan said. So it's, how do we make it economically viable for people to do that? And so the transfer of development is a way that we can do that. I think the goal is to keep it separate from downtown, so we don't have the competition of the convention center and TFAR, because that has put a real, lull in the market there. And so it's not final yet, and there's different opinions on this of whether the TFAR would stay in the Arts District. The good thing about the Arts District is that there are so many parking lots that there are really good areas for increased density. And so you can, be moving density around within this area and still not have significant impacts in terms of, an adjacent building. So the goal is to be as flexible as possible. We've heard feedback that a conditional use permit would not be a smart idea because it's tied to a certain process. So I spoke with planning yesterday in preparation for coming to you, and they are looking at doing a much simpler process. So that's good news for everybody that they're looking at simple. So that is one of the cornerstones, is because the TFAR program has not necessarily been as successful downtown as everybody had hoped, and they tended to kind of lower the market because the city has so much TFAR, is that we would have a special TFAR process just for the Arts District.
Are you looking for
The feedback, yeah. I did bring pad and paper. So this is very much, we're doing outreach, wanting to make sure that if people have comments or concerns, that we're able to integrate that in our discussions with planning. And because we want this to be something that everybody is excited about and thinks is going to work.
So would this plan be in conjunction with the 2040 plan? Would you be working with them? And
they would be one of the tools in the toolbox is how the planners word it. Okay. So this would be part of the plan, so
when they issue with the
it's part of the community plan.
Yeah.
So when they issue with the new FAR, these would be additional incentives and so forth. It would be within the allotted district.
And one of the things they're looking at, which I think is really good, is they are looking at not having the FAR in the arts district so huge that the TFAR has no value. So if everything were zoned for 40 stories, most people aren't going to build 60 stories here. So trying to kind of take that into account so that it creates a market for the sale of the TFAR.
Do you have any indication of what that market value would be? What is the proposal? Or do you have a book that?
It would be based on the market. So in a really hot real estate market, you would be getting more for
so
your.
So it's really a free economy?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Unless you guys think differently about that.
It seems like a good fit for just an extra tool in the toolbox, as you said, in terms of carrying it forward. Whether or not it gets utilized, you're right, it's really market dependent upon time, and whether it makes sense for the property owner with their property versus the vacant parking lot, as used as an example. I think it creates another opportunity for us to use as a tool as we look at it from the neighborhood. And I think it should help achieve the goal of trying to preserve some of these lower density existing buildings that have the right criteria that you mentioned. I think it accomplishes both goals.
Yeah. I mean, to me, it sounds like this is a group of property owners in the neighborhood that it has to be kind of a collective motivation of how to kind of protect what we call the arts district. Because if everybody kind of think of, well, I'll just do my own thing and hopefully the five cool warehouses in the neighborhood stay there, and then 5 years later they all disappear and the entire block looks the same, the kind of collective value of the neighborhood is certainly going to be diminishing. So I think we would probably get a good feedback from this group as far as figuring out how to build a smart grid that it actually works and not just becomes a piece of paper and planning.
Yeah, we're all going to have to get the word out, what the people, show how this can be done, how you can have a really great project. Because there's enough examples of how you integrate historic buildings into a new project that we think that by having this opportunity, this tool, that more people, it will be an easier sell than just saying, oh my God, I love that building, I can't possibly keep that building. So.
Well, what happens after the 25-year period is up?
It would just be a covenant for 25 years. So then,
and then what? You get additional air rights back?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I don't know that we've answered that question. We're trying to have some control, so at least for a period of time, the building would be protected, but that's a great question. Do you guys have an opinion on what the answer should be for that question?
Duh. Yeah, I don't know. I think we should get air rights back. The ability to sell additional air rights.
So sell them again.
Maybe another
one.
Maybe
you would have. Essentially, you would have sold your air rights.
No, but yeah.
But you get them back.
You're trading
one off.
Why should it be permanent if you sold it?
Well, the question is, what happens to the neighborhood? After 25 years, the company goes away, I can now sell my building to some developer who wants to tear my building down.
Well, that's only
so question. What happens is then the entire community would then, after 25 years, would start to morph again in a certain direction. I'm not sure if that means
the goals. Well, not the whole community, because if it's designated individually like the Biscuit Company, it is in perpetuity because it's tied to the designation. Mm-hmm. So that, you asked me the question, we're not treating the buildings fairly. So maybe it should just be that everybody's in perpetuity then.
It might be.
Yeah. Because then you wouldn't face this in 25 mm-hmm. years. We
right.
have to go through all this.
Somebody used your air rights and it's in perpetuity.
Yeah.
So it's not.
I mean, you can always apply to the city for anything you want. Before we know that. But if you strip your air rights, it seems to me maybe you strip them for good.
Yeah. That's a really good comment.
25 so, years goes fast. Some of us have discovered.
I guess that other one could always buy back TFAR after 25 years if they wanted to redevelop their property from somebody else.
Yeah.
I mean, you could look at it that way too, right? I don't know, it gets complicated.
Yeah.
A lot of different solutions.
That's why this is, you want it to be so simple it works.
Right.
But it's, I would love to see how Seattle and San Francisco have fared to send somebody up and do a little white paper on lessons learned and anybody else. Because every city has a warehouse district that, you know, Beijing does. That has this kind of creativity. And it's going to be overloved if we don't watch out.
Does that mean my building falls down because of an earthquake? Can I now build a building of the standard FAR? I mean, do I get the 1.5 back?
That's a good question, too.
That we have?
That's a great question.
And what if you burn it down?
You mean
now I need to rebuild my building, or I want to rebuild my building because it's more efficient. Can I just have the regular 1.5?
I think you would have whatever your building had that you hadn't sold off. But that's a really good question. Maybe we need to have some kind of provision in there for disaster.
And what about alterations?
Alterations are reviews.
If you stucco over a beautiful, put a drop ceiling.
Interiors, this is not about interiors. So this is just the exterior, unless it's an HCM, and then they never mill that contract, and the interiors come into play.
How can this group help you? I mean, this is a very representative group with a lot of history of doing business in this.
Sure. How does this tie into existing buildings that have already turned into condos or have multiple people on them? How does this work with that?
So in terms of the condo situation, the homeowners association or the condo association could then sell the air rights to another project, because you're not probably not going to be building whatever your the rest of your AR would be, so you'd be able to sell it.
The air rights.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Michael, you don't need to sell the air rights.
You don't.
You
could
keep them.
Yeah.
No, it's up to you.
I understand. I'm not selling them.
He's been practicing in pocket.
I was going to put money in my pocket.
And shake the building.
So Dan asked how you guys can be most helpful, and today this conversation has been really helpful. As you think about this more, and I don't have my email address on that one sheet, I don't think it's stupid on my part. But you can just go to the Conservancy website.
Miguel
Conservancy. Yeah, thank you, that was great. But if you have, you think, like, you wake up tomorrow morning and go, this would be great if they added this, then just send me a quick email, because we are really looking for feedback, and you guys are a great group, and you represent property owners, and that's the focus of this. So if you have more thoughts, please let us know. We're happy to come back when this gets a little more fleshed out and talk about it with you. And it's probably, they're not sure at planning. The community plan is gonna come out probably in early fall, probably September or October. This may or may not be in it. They wanna have the concept in the plan, but it fleshed out. It probably won't be as fleshed out as we all would like it. But that gives us time before it goes to the City Planning Commission, which probably won't be until January. So we have time, the good news is, so we can make it, we have time to make it great and workable. But we also kind of need to keep moving too. So if that sounds good to you guys, that would be perfect. So keep giving us ideas. And Dan and you all have been great to work with in this process, really providing the real world in terms of what matters to a property owner and what's happening in the Arts District. So I just want to say, thank you so much to both of you for this. There's a lot of you have done really great work in the Arts District, and the City Street Project is wonderful. So the goal really is to keep what everyone loves and make sure that it's integrated into the future of the Arts District.
Thank you for coming.
Okay, good. Thank
can you.
You
just tell us your email?
Sure, I can just tell you. It's L Dishman, D-I-S-H-M-A-N, at laconservancy.org. I don't have enough for the whole group, but I'm
probably going to be yelling.
Yeah.
Are you filming, or and what is the nature of this? I'm just wondering, because this is it.
And it's also on the City of LA website,
what is this for?
If you want to get it bigger, because it's kind of hard to read, but if you read it on the computer, wasn't able to get that better before.
Yeah, what you want to do.
Good, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Tim Harder, Bird Scooter.
Our neighbors changed overnight. It's only 40, so they've arrived. So my name's Tim. I do government affairs for Southern California and Arizona. I've been with the company for about 2 months. I came from State Assembly Member Richard Bloom's office from Santa Monica, so I handled housing, homelessness, and transportation for the Southern River for the past 5 years. And now I am with Bird. So that's a little bit about me. So you've seen them around town. We have a soft pilot launch that we did in Arts District to see how it's going. Bird's an electric motorized scooter rental company, safe, reliable, last mile electric transportation for everyone. All the benefits of a shared electric vehicle with a footprint smaller than a bicycle. So you can see it's just back there in the corner. And that's my helmet as well that's on there as well. Bird is helping cities reduce traffic and congestion, reducing parking problems. Wow, it was really hard to park in this neighborhood. Reduce carbon emissions, promote local businesses, provide affordable transportation, and there's no city investment needed because you're already using this infrastructure. Promoting local businesses, support 911, point that out. Passing out little cards. We do nest with businesses as well to get people in your doors. So like in Santa Monica, we'll have bookstores or coffee shops that reach out to us, restaurants. They want to be a nest location, they're grabbing lunch on their break, on their lunch break. Then they have them to jump on a Bird scooter, get back into where they need to go. That expands their circle radius, that short distance. So it allows them to know that those birds are going to be at that nest location because that's one of the spots that we choose. Reducing carbon emissions for every bird that's on the market. Imagine there's one car trip. It's equivalent to about 1 pound of carbon gas that we're saving for each scooter that each ride that happens. So Bird's easy to find. If you pop up your app right now, you'll download the Bird app. There's about 40 in the Arts District. You can see them. I just took a picture on my phone. You walk up, you scan it, there's a little QR code. The QR code is not working, there's a little digital code that you can also type in, it's 4 letters. And it unlocks, and you zip off to where you need to go. It's really affordable, you see down here, 10 minutes, a mile, a little under 2 miles, $2.50, exactly from point A to exact point B. So safety first is our thing. The state law right now is to always wear a helmet. So we give out free helmets to encourage that. Through our app, so after you take your first ride, if you request a free helmet, and helmet comes to you 7 to 10 business days. That's 15 miles per hour max speed. They actually come at 22 miles per hour. We de-throttle them at 15 miles per hour because that's where cities were comfortable, and that's where we're comfortable with people still feel like they're getting somewhere where they need to get without having to call a TNC transit network that company Uber Lyft. Driver's license scan, so we just added that feature in about a few weeks ago, so you have to have a driver's license, so now when you first open up your app, it'll ask you for your driver's license. Must be 18 plus, that's our company policy. And then one rider per bird, no double riding. Always follow all traffic laws, park your bird safely. We added this on the floorboard of our Bird scooters. So we're the only company that does this. A cop can pull you over and say, oh, I didn't know. It's literally right at your feet. So not required, license required, no riding on sidewalks. No double riding, 18 plus years old. That email is their support. That phone number is 24/7 and someone answers. The Bird difference, smart scaling, demand determined supply. So if our birds aren't being used, then we're not gonna do business in that community. Active bird management, we pull every bird off the road every night. So at 8 p.m. the network shuts down. All of our chargers go out and pick it up. Small footprint, just talk about that, less clutter. You can fit about in this little space right here, you'd be able to fit 4 birds right in this little area right here. Charger program, it's skilled and unskilled jobs, income for your community. So we recruit local people that live in the community based on their address and have them be our chargers. They're sitting on the couch watching TV, it's 8:15. Oh, there's money on my sidewalk. There's $5 out there, $5 to $20 per scooter. Yeah, we'll send you 3 chargers. It's like plugging your laptop. Takes about 15 cents to 85 cents of energy. And it charges it up just like a laptop. Put it out the next morning in a pre-approved nest location between 5 and 6 a.m. That's a bird nest. there's three birds per nest. We're playing around that number currently, but right now it's three. One or two feels like, oh, that's someone's scooter. Three feels like, oh, I can get the, like, these are for the public. Bird SOS pledge is our Save Our Sidewalks pledge. We launched this on March 27th. We gave this to every other dockless mobility company that's currently operating in California. So far, no one else has signed on. Daily pickup, we operate a program designed to retrieve all of our vehicles from city streets every night. So we look over our vehicles, make sure they're in operating order, fully charged back up, and back out. Responsible growth will not increase the number of vehicles in an area unless they're being used on average at least three times per vehicle per day. So if those birds out there in our district aren't being used at least three times a day, then we're going to pull them out of the district. $1 revenue sharing. So immediately when we launch in LA, per scooter per day, a pot gets put outside in the city of Los Angeles. We're asking for that to be put into infrastructure, bike lanes, promote safe riding, and maintain our safe infrastructure. So if there's 1,000 scooters in the city of LA, $365,000 a year. Working together, we're happy to share data. We share data with the LA, with the city. Work together to craft a customized program to suit the unique challenges of your community. Let us know the best way to work together. That's my email, and that's all I got. So we launched with 40 scooters in the Arts District. I saw a couple of them already being used out there when I just came over. So I parked really far away, and looked for a scooter, parked over like our worst scooter area, and then walked, opened my app, grabbed a scooter, and scooted over here. That's pretty much it. Also on the utilization cap, so on average, we're seeing about 1.5 miles as our trip. So average distance is the first mile, last mile. In Santa Monica, it's about 1.7. But our whole network was about 1.5 as our average trip. I can take questions. Hope that goes your best.
And so are you guys permitted by the city of LA?
So it's per council district. So you put your council member, and then we talk with Weezer, and you give it to the Arts District. So it's a limited rollout. We'll see how it operates. If the numbers stay the same, then we'll put more in to get that demand. That demand is there. The demand is not there, and then we'll decrease the supply.
How many of the truck calls are there?
So you use this for the first time, you get to bring your own helmet?
Yes. For the first time, yes. Yeah. Because we don't want people dancing that and then just requesting it for help right away. Because they're about $50 each, so it's a nice like helmet that we send out, and we just want users to be using them, not just to sort of get on happy with free helmet. Good question.
How long is the test
area? So there's no limit on it. We're just sort of seeing how it operates. We can be, there's regulations that are pending at the city level, but the chair did send it back to the DOT for them to redo those regulations that they send up, so we'll be seeing them back in August.
But from the, you said you're going to test the odds this
year? Yeah, data, right? We're going to see how data
is
showing up.
So are you going to give it 2 days, 4 days?
I would say we'll probably keep it going as long as it's operating fine. Yeah, maybe we won't take it out if it's not operating.
So if I go someplace and I get out after 8 o'clock, my rights.
Correct. Unless you lock, you can lock your bird and unlock it. But if you end your ride, you cannot start a new ride after 8 p.m. So you can start a ride at any time and lock it and just keep it going. But you have to end your ride. It's taken to put on the charging mat. So then you have like $5. It's like Pokemon Go. You see a bunch of like money all over the sidewalk. So I started out the charger. I work for government, so I need to sell my income. So I would go pick up birds on my way home. I would just drive home on the route, pick up those three birds, charge them, put them out next morning for next work, and then do it the next day as well.
Who is Bird? Who owns it and who finds it?
Sure. So Travis is our CEO. He came from Uber. He was at Uber and Lyft. So he sort of knows the first mile, last mile thing. I talk with Uber drivers and Lyft drivers a lot, and they love it because they hate picking up those half mile, 1 mile trips. They want longer trips, and so we figured it's like the right solution for it. It's just a niche market that I think we've got.
Is he even sold longer?
He is. Yeah, and venture capital is worth money. Recently. Yeah, so you guys might have seen the news. There's rumors of a billion-dollar valuation.
Passed to a billion-dollar valuation.
Yeah, so that's all rumored right now. No, there's no comment on that, but yeah, we're growing fast.
Are you only in California right now, or are you like?
We're in 15 other cities: Nashville, Atlanta, DC, Miami, Denver, Austin, and then San Francisco, San Diego, San Jose, Los Angeles, and we might be in 50 markets by the end of the year.
So you mentioned you pick these up every night.
Correct.
So last night I was walking around the neighborhood about 10 o'clock, and there were, I counted four, just sitting in the middle of the sidewalk, unattended.
So that we, I think we launched yesterday.
Okay.
So they're all picking up. Yeah, so they're both. So those bounties will go up, right? Because if they're not, they'll start out at $5. So by 10:30, those bounties are $20 per scooter.
Ooh. Well, my concern is that given our neighborhood and the homeless population in this area, that they're going to just be picked up and walk away.
So we're still working on that. We built that in San Francisco. Our inventory loss percentage is really small, actually. Not as big of an issue as you think it would be, but we have ways to address those kind of things of fraud and stealing and stuff like that. They're GPS, so we can call the police, actually, once our dog's been taken for more than 48 hours and have them go to an address and grab our product.
And if we're interested in becoming a bird nest location, how do we go about doing that?
You can contact me, and I can put you in touch with the right person. Actually, what I'll do is I'll share it with you, you guys' board. There's an email address on there. There's not. But there's an email address that you can connect directly to and ask to be a nest. And again, it's only three birds, though. If you guys want more, just let me know, and I can ask for that additional nest for your location. And just happened that this happened today, the past couple days. Like, I think I reached out like 4 weeks ago because we were talking about coming to Arts District. And then this timing actually just like fell in perfectly. We're really excited to be here. You know, sustainable, first mile, last mile solution. We feel like it's going to be great in this area, getting people like bars, freeing up those parking spaces. That's really what our goal is.
What happened if we drive outside of the district?
So if you drive outside of districts, it's fine. You can go anywhere you want, but there'll be a higher bounty on that scooter to get reintroduced into the market the next day, right? So if we have like chargers in, say, the Arts District area, we'll put a $10 bounty maybe on that one if it's farther away.
So you can drop it wherever you want.
Somebody's more incentive to bring it back.
Yeah, point A, point B. Yeah, wherever you go. So I mean, we're in Santa Monica, we'll see people take rides all the way to West Hollywood, Santa Monica. It gets 15 miles on a 4-H.
15
so,
miles.
Yeah, 15 miles on a 4-H.
This might sound like a silly question.
No, not silly questions.
Birds ride in the car lane or in the bicycle lane?
Bicycle lane, bike lanes. Okay. So there is sidewalk riding that does happen. You recognize that. That's the issue that cities are having. We're really working really hard to figure that out. What the issue is people feel protected in their 3,000-pound car, and they don't feel protected in the bike lane. So we're trying to get more people with bike lanes, right? So then this car starts slowing down. I'm getting them off the sidewalk. But again, if you've never gotten out of your car before, once you get on a bicycle or a scooter, you want to be on the sidewalks where you feel safe. Mm-hmm. So we're working on that. The safety issue is a big one, and that's why I think
So what's the range of this thing per day?
So it depends on how fully it's throttled down, but on average, it's about 15 miles per full charge. Mm-hmm. And instantly when the bird dies, it gets below 20% of the battery, it gets taken off the access map and put on the charger map. So I mean, we have birds popping on the charger map as early as noon.
So how are some of the laws, rules enforced? Because my kids have these things, I think they've broken every rule on there. They don't have helmets, they don't have driver's license.
Yeah.
They ride on the sidewalk.
So we do partnerships with you guys. There's an event happening out, we do like a safety outreach, right? We'll come to a tent, we'll do a safety, a helmet giveaway. We got people on rides, showing them how to do it, how to use it. We have safety ambassador, a team that I just launched in Southern California, so I launched in San Diego and see how it does. It's people in vests that walk around removing scooters and putting them off the side by bike rack. People talking to users about user education. Hey, you need a helmet. Here's a free helmet. Just, please do that. Please no double riding. If we see really aggressive behavior, we can terminate an account.
Right.
So we do that sometimes, but we try to use reservation around safety.
And the driver's license is new?
Yeah, there's going to be an issue with that, we think, around immigration stuff and, you know, California and all that stuff.
Right.
We're currently addressing that. We'll see how it happens. There is legislation pending at the state right now that would make us a separate class vehicle. And electric bicycle rules would be, those electric bicycle rules would be mirrored in our class as well. So they don't require helmets. So we'd be the sort of same category.
What about insurance? What if you drive into somebody?
So it's identification, $5 million per incident. City's not responsible, you're not responsible. This
you,
is not
you are. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I drive into somebody.
Yeah, we identify the whole, the first scooters for $1 million per incident.
So you guys aren't the only scooter company, right? There's a few others.
Correct.
So eventually in the future...
I have no idea what you're talking about.
And there might, potentially in the future, there might be a scenario where there's all these different scooters from different companies all on the sidewalk, right? Do you foresee that to be a challenge for neighborhoods when you have, you got your nest there right next to you, another nest or another collection of bikes?
I don't know how it's going to play out, you know. I think what we're trying to get at is so that to deal with the clutter issue, right, and having 20 scooters, like, you know, five companies, you know, five nests, is that if your scooter or your bicycle is not being used, you have to take it out of the market. And that's what we're really trying to hold city speak to the fire on that data sharing, because we're sharing data, right, so you're going to be able to hold us accountable. And we think we should hold all companies accountable, including us. And that's our policy. That's why if we're not going to be used at least 3 times a day. So, right, if you have that many scooters, right, there's going to be certain ones that are not going to stick out, right? They're going to not do as well. If they're not going to do the safety outreach that we do, they're not going to do the pre-helmet stuff, like, they're not going to be good players, and those people aren't going to get used. And so that's what we're going to do with that, I think. Right? And so, like, a bicycle, a shared bicycle gets used on average 0.74 times a day. So not even one full time a day is a good full ride. And so, our scooters are getting 3 to 12 times. So, you know, those are car trips already taking off the road. So that's the kind of thing you figure out. I don't think there should be a cap, it should be a utilization cap. You don't want to have a static cap, right? You want to be able to scale based on the demand.
Cool. Thanks a lot for coming.
Yeah, of course. Thanks, everyone.
You have an artist report this month?
No, there really isn't anything. I did have one thing, though, that I wanted to bring up and ask about, possibly it's being thought about. And that's to deal with that parking garage that's, you know, in the middle of the Arts District. Talk maybe on that at some point. Has there been any research in getting the county to somehow release some of that parking through the Arts District for events, for restaurants, for art openings?
Talking about the county parking lot?
Yeah, someone that sits empty, you know, in the evening and not available. And,
where
that's sort of a different thing, but I just still think it's kind of part of the relate for the art
system.
Okay. Because it's not on the agenda, maybe we can agendize it for the next
Do you want to go to the report? Do you want to go to the
okay. Is it up? We met on, was it Monday? Yes. It's Monday, and we discussed, we finally approved a new mission. I don't know if I have it here, but the new missions. But essentially, it's to advocate for the neighborhood and to help promote more art and support businesses. I'm sure that's not it. But no, that's very similar to what it is. But in any case, so after many months of meeting and working on trying to reorganize and focus the organization, we condensed all of the different activities into 3 different committees. So there's a business committee, the arts committee, and the community committee. And so all of the different work that we do will fall into one of these 3 committees that would allow us, like I said, to be a little bit more focused in our work. And also, as part of that, we revamped the mission statement and the vision. Did I forget anything, Dan? So that's the latest update.
Sorry, excuse me. You can even refer to that.
You remember?
Thanks.
Thank you. You can adjourn the ALA meeting and call the VID agenda to order. Do you have any public comments? Actually, we have,
We have public comments?
Yeah.
Yes, it looks like we have one public comment.
Hi, my name is Katie Kiefer. I am new with CD14. I'm here to introduce myself. I am the new downtown field and public works coordinator out of the downtown, or City Hall, for the downtown team. I was just at a Little Rama meeting. I did get a district drive with Miguel, thank you. Just quick background, I've come from commercial real estate. I used to work at South Park Business Improvement District. And now my purview is to blend the field work that happens in downtown with all of the different public works elements, which is very vast. So I will be working on a lot of different things specific to the arts district, whether it's the bridge to curbs or parking, very broad. So I'm looking forward to diving in with the arts district. I also live at 4th and Main, so I'm a resident in downtown. I like to bring all those different lenses to the table when I look at what's going on in our neighborhood. Just want to say hello, and I will be coming to board meetings whenever I can. I don't have business cards, but whoever wants my contact information, I'll stay around after and give it to you. Thanks. Oh, and congratulations on renewing.
Welcome to CD14.
Thank you.
Financial report, Miguel.
Yes, let's find our financial documents so that we may review them. All right, so we're looking at the budget, the operating financial report for the month of May. This month we received $21,162. From the city assessments, you know, we were kind of estimating that it would be a little bit higher, as you can see there, it's like $498,000. That's actually coming in the month of June, so we kind of got that wrong there. But so year to date, we received $560,000 in assessment dollars. So we're about halfway there in terms of receiving assessment dollars from the city. If you look at our administration expenses, we've got a total of $15,902. Usual admin expenses, the salary is a little bit higher than normal for this month just because it was 3 pay periods in the month of May. So as the year goes on, we're going to continue, that'll still be on under budget. So year to date, we are $93,960 for the admin expenses year to date. And that is, as you can see, a little bit over than what we projected, but that's because we've had some expenses early on in the year, like the bid renewal, right, insurance costs, things like that. So as the year goes on, we're going to start to see we're either going to be at budget or below budget. So if we look at our operations, this is the expenses, operation expenses. For the clean team, this month we were at $34,769, a little bit under budget. We did have a little extra power washing this month, and we'll probably continue to do so for the next couple months. Got a lot of dirty sidewalks out there. Let's see here. We also have our total safety expenses. Total safety expenses for the year, or I'm sorry, for this month is $43,159. So this month, we went ahead and increased the starting minimum wage. So that took us right to essentially at budget, right? A little bit under budget. But we also, at the end of this month, hired 2 new security guards. So we are, as of now, fully staffed. So next month, that the total cost for the safety team is going to be a little bit higher, but it's okay because just remember we've had cost savings every month. So just look, something to keep an eye on. Our total clean and safe expenses for year to date, we're at $379,258. Right, that's a little bit, we've got a little bit of this cost savings there year to date. So the total, going back to the month of May though, the total expenses for the month of May, $96,816.99. That's what we paid in the month of May to be operating. Go to the next page. We're going to look at our cash flow. So
as you look at the assessment received, you can see how much money we received from the city of LA. I'm sorry, I skipped one line there. On net, total net income was $75,654 per month. So then, going back to cash flow, as I was saying, you can see the amount of assessment dollars we received in January, February, March, April, May. This month, again, we received $21,000. We had expenses of $96,816. So you can see what the full amount of money that we have in the in our account there. $428,049. That is the main account.
In June, usually we get another cash infusion. Is that fine?
It's probably a little bit more.
Have a motion to accept the financial report. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any against? Any abstention? Operations report. Maintenance report.
Hi everyone, Grace from Chrysalis here. Your report should be the bottom of your stack of papers, same as every month. Looking at the data this month, it looks like kind of the biggest change is we had a big increase in bulky items. Most of that comes from actually, in talking to Julius, the supervisor out there, been an increase in illegal dumping. So I'm not sure if leases are turning over, people are moving, it's mainly in the residential areas. And you can see some of the photos of that on the back. So that's sort of the biggest thing they've been encountering in May. Otherwise, they're kind of just trucking along. They have noticed anecdotally a lot of graffiti is on murals, so a little bit less than we're taking off, but trying to let the right people know about that. Otherwise, that's it.
Just want to add that we had talked about this in the past about getting trash cans. So this is what probably almost a year ago we talked about this, but at that time, we missed the city's deadline. However, the city renegotiated its contract with Toter trash cans, so their trash cans will be delivered probably next week.
That's the same ugly plastic thing?
Yes. $200-something a can, which is if we were to go to buy these directly from any of the company, $1,000 a year.
How much are the metal ones?
The metal ones are all the mesh ones, but yeah. Those mesh ones are probably $600.
They're $500.
Really?
Mm-hmm. $600, we should make an hot food out of it and get two hours to
bring
it.
So as I'm sure you've all seen the cans, those are the original cans that we had when we started the bid. A lot of them melted, the tops have been ripped off, right? Graffiti and all sorts of things. I'm sure you don't even want to know what goes in there. But
we will do our best to keep them this clean.
But you're going to see we're going to replace a lot of the cans hopefully by next week. And then there's also some places that have been built, like at Mateo and some other places we're going to locate new cans.
Just that one question. And I've never asked the question, but how big is the crew that's out like every day? I assume they're out every day.
Yep,
every
day.
How many people is it that do all this heavy lifting?
Absolutely. So it's they're out there from 7 to 4, all 7 days of the week. And it depends a little bit on the day. Saturday was a little bit more because late when there was farmers market. So it kind of waves anything between 4 and 6 people up there a day. Oh, actually on the cart, and then our driver around as well.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah,
Oscar. Hello, my name's Oscar. Just wanted to let you guys know that crimes have been kind of down in other parts, but we're still having a little bit of vehicle break-in. People are still getting stuck inside vehicles, people from out of town, out of state. We talked to them, they know they're aware that they're supposed to put their belongings inside their vehicle, but now it's just happening randomly. Like if we focus on one area, they're watching us. So sometimes what they're doing is they break into a car and then they go to Skid Row. And then they come back with a different sweater, a different bike. So we're watching them and we got reports from people that live actually inside their vehicles that they've seen the people that do the break-ins. They said that sometimes they hang out on Olympic and Avenida by the 76 gas station where they try to sell whatever item they can come out from the vehicle. So we already, we're watching them more careful, we're being more careful when they're out there riding their bikes. Those are the ones that are causing, because it happens so quick, because we're patrolling on a regular basis. And sometimes these guys just come here and they're gone. in seconds, and we just finished passing through. So just give you guys a heads up, please put your belongings inside the vehicle somewhere safe where they're not able, where they're not visible. Other than that, everything's going pretty well. Response is really good.
Probably asked this question three times, but I keep forgetting.
No,
what is observation?
When we observe something, when we observe somebody like riding a bike, a suspicious person or something, that's what we observe.
Someone's peering into cars,
yes.
Checking doors.
Yes.
The irregular behavior of someone.
Yes.
Okay. And the other one that seems to give a high count, location and hotspots.
Oh, that's where stuff happens. Like the other day, there was like on Ivory, we had an incident where somebody got mugged. You know, the guy just came and just gave me your wallet. And, you know, he looked at his license and goes, well, I know where you live, so don't report. Stuff like that. That's a hotspot. So we're checking it like 3 or 4 times a day.
Oh, so you return to the
yes.
same location?
Yes. 4 times an hour. Yes.
We had a number of break-ins in our condo recently.
What's the address?
It's the Toy Warehouse. And even as of just a couple of days ago. Even right after we installed a very expensive security system.
Yeah.
But I'm just curious, I don't know if you were there, Miguel, at one point, if this is... Is this a trend elsewhere? Is it our building?
Yeah.
And it seems like bicycles have been hit quite a bit, breaking into the secure cages and cars.
The Beacon Lots.
It happens across the street all the time.
Yeah.
We just have bicycles.
So yeah, they're getting more.
Yes.
Seems like we got hit like 4 or 5 times in the last 2 weeks.
So this is a trend that's happening all over the neighborhood, Beacon Lofts, Parker Block, right? They are forcing entry through the door. In situations like that, like the Beacon Lofts, they were having quite a few break-ins like that, so we parked the vehicle there as a decoy. Right? Has that been effective?
Yes. Yes, I believe that. I mean, I get so happy.
So it's working, right?
Yeah, but all our residents
okay.
are really happy.
Okay, good.
So if that continues to be a problem in any building, we're happy to either try to get a real LAPD decoy car, park our truck there, right? But also, we're constantly looking at, our guys know all the residential buildings, and we're looking to see where all the entrances are. Is there somebody who's trying to sneak in behind somebody, right? Those are the kind of things we're looking for. But you're absolutely right, it is happening to all the different residents.
Yeah. More so than you than in the past.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
During the day.
Because they sneak in, because most of the time we even take pictures of sometimes gates that are open for 5 or 6 seconds, they just walk in.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know if they actually belong to the building or not, or if they're a resident.
Well, now we have a little footage, so I guess.
Yeah,
somebody's
every time
that
we get footage, we pass it down to the rest of the guys to keep an eye out for them. And yes, and then they go follow us right away.
If you capture people who do break into your buildings on a security camera, please send those images to us. We put them all up in the office, and our guys come in every day, and they take a good look at people, just to make sure if we see them on the streets, we're keeping an eye on them.
Good. If you guys have like a map where all these key hotspots are, do you want to start?
No, we don't. But what the thing is that we do is we write it down on the chalkboard inside our office, so we let the guys know, hey, don't forget to check this. It's just
it's never changing list based on
it's not the same place.
It's not. It doesn't know LAPD has them all in a GIS system.
They do.
Yeah.
Yes, they have. They're more accurate.
Yeah, the county sheriff has
yes.
the same thing.
They have, you can go on, if you Google LA Times crime maps, you can see exactly where all the incidents are.
Quite fascinating.
Yeah,
right. And adjacent to the liquor stores, I mean, there's some things you can observe quite clearly. Graphically on the map.
And then how many officers do you guys have?
I don't know. 11.
Oh, no, 4 per shift.
4 per shift. Yes.
It varies on the shift, though.
Yeah. And also on graveyard, it goes down to 2.
Okay. Yes. Well, there's a person with a weapon, so we had 7 incidents.
Sometimes when we're asking people to relocate, they have knives inside the shopping carts. They have weapons because they gotta protect themselves also.
This is not a gun necessarily.
No, it's just a weapon. It could be like a stick that they use for support because they also run into incidents also. Like they come and ask us for their help because they're getting also assaulted also by other transits. So they gotta carry weapons themselves to survive on the streets. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to get your back to your report.
Yes, so as many of you know, we've been moving through the renewal process. So the ballots were counted on Tuesday. The city council approved the ordinance to reestablish the arts district bid on Wednesday. So congratulations, everybody. All the ballots cast, 90.6% of them were yay votes, aye votes. And then 10% were nine point something percent no votes.
What was the percentage of voting?
It was there was something like there were 40 ballots that were deemed that were not recorded because they were, people forgot to sign or didn't put their name, and then there was about 260 yes votes, and then.
But what about dollars? You're equating dollars, not in.
In terms, I don't know what percentage we see. $800,000 worth of property owners cast their vote. That makes sense.
Really?
75% of the assessed value of property owners represent 75% of the assessed value in cash amounts.
That's great. Well, thanks for all your hard work.
And every property owner who urged a neighbor to vote yes, it was all you guys, it was all the property owners. I was sitting in the clerk's office and they were counting all the different ballots and I kept saying no, I was getting a little worried. Then I saw Metro come in.
That's 5 years?
That's 5 years.
And that's the new boundaries. That's the new boundaries starting January 1st.
So starting January 1st, we're going to hit the ground running. So we're going to start preparing to think about how many different security guards are we going to need for the entire new area, and how many folks are we going to need sweeping the streets. So, I think I will come back to you with different proposals. We can play with how to increase or decrease certain services. Some of the things I'm thinking about is we might have somebody on staff on the Chrysalis side who all they do is just detail, scrape film off of the sidewalks, film LA tape for fences, things like that, and just take the time to really make the neighborhood nice. That's an idea. But again, I'll present all proposals to the board, and you guys can take a look at and see what you think is best.
Do we have to renew or re-sign all the contract? Because it's like a new entity, right?
I
assume all the contracts must terminate at the end of our first. I'm not sure.
So the security contract was originally for 3 years, it lapsed. We just signed a new one, right? That one was for 1 year. So at that,
we'll terminate the recovery.
Yes.
We need to vote, or to renew, or to renew.
Yes. So there's that one. Chrysalis is, we have also, that contract has also lapsed, but I recommended to go out to RFP for security services. I'm not recommending to go out to RFP for clean services, but if that's something you'd like to consider, we can. But currently, we're on a month-to-month basis with Chrysalis.
Is it a choice, or are we obligated to actually solicit this?
It's a choice. We can continue to operate as we are and continue our partnership with Chrysalis and the security company, or we can go out and bid again.
Looking back at the financial, in January of this year, we had, at the beginning of the year, $330,000 plus or minus. I presume we're going to be about the same. Does that mean we're going to have $300,000 to figure out what we want to do?
So some of that is going to go for these trash cans that we just purchased. That's about $20,000. But then you're right, you're going to have a decision. The other things, other items that are going to come up is our patrol vehicle is over 100,000 miles now. So potentially getting a new vehicle is something to consider. What else? Just, there's endless, we can buy different kinds of paint, all sorts of things. New trash cans, more trash cans, right? More staff.
You spend it on?
Well, we could hire another safety guard, another security guard, or another, the assessment dollars, as long as
I think we should see what happens with the minimum wage increase, and I think we should see how that affects our budget, and then we should have that conversation.
I think the budget is the time we can make this.
Exactly.
But to answer your question, you can use that money anyway as long as it conforms to the management plan.
I will say that Chrysalis has a reputation for significantly valuable work, and that to me is a material consideration.
They also are the largest employer of formerly homeless individuals.
We should start showing Chrysalis employees of how to do the charging of the bird.
Meeting's adjourned. Oh, actually, one thing to discuss actually on new business would be the summer recess. Typically, we usually have July and then recess in August. I'm not sure if you guys want to vote now.
In the past, we've taken a month off.
Yeah, so the summer basically scheduled. I'm not sure if July, I guess it comes down to people are here or not. People for July or for July or for August. Minimum wage are scheduled now.
On my side, August is the worst.
Yeah, that's generally what it is.
But it is what it is. So if I can't make that meeting.
So you prefer August?
I prefer not to have a meeting in August. So July.
Is that something people can send me y'all to review their schedules. Let's see, because there's general. So as of right now, we'll be on to have a July meeting. Okay. Because we need to circulate. You need to do it. Thank you.